going in a direction. So don't think I'm trying to push you aside. But when we look at double-minded, you either believe or you don't. And that's basically what it comes down to in the book of James. And when we look at faith and hope, and now I'm backing up a little bit, they are connected by one word. When we look for the definition of faith, we are going to jump into Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. And for the sake of time, we're not going to turn there, but everyone's going to be familiar with it, because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So we have that word faith and hope in the exact same verse. And they're connected by that word substance. Now, if we look at the Greek meaning for that word substance, more times than any other in the New Testament, it was used and translated confident or confidence. So when we look at hope and faith, there's nothing about doubting in there, but it's all about confidence. I know with assurance. There's no way to waver over here. There's no way to waver over there. Mom said I might, that I'll get this cookie. Is she going to give it to me? Is it? There's no sense of that at all in hope or faith. Those two words run on one word, and that is confidence and assurance. That if this is what was said, this is exactly what is going to happen. And when we look at faith, and here in the book of James, chapter 1, that's exactly what James is discussing. When it comes to faith, there is no wavering, there is no question. Faith is taking it at face value. If this is what is said, this is the way it's going to be. And when we look at what James wrote, he said, act in faith, nothing wavering. So when we look at that nothing wavering, it's a contradiction or the opposite of what faith is. And time again, when we look at the Word of God, God gives us assurance here, and he gives us assurance there, that this is what I've said, this is what I'm going to do. And if someone would please read Matthew chapter 21, Matthew 21 and verse 22, Matthew 21, 22. Someone else, John chapter 16 and verse 23. John 16, 23. And I will find 1 John chapter 5. Does someone have Matthew 21 and verse 22?
And all things whatsoever she asks in prayer, believing, he shall receive.
And some things that you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. That's not that what that verse says. What does it say?
All things.
All things. Read that verse one more time, Mom. So all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, you shall receive. What about John chapter 16 and verse 23?
And in that day ye shall ask. And in that day ye shall ask me nothing verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you.
And some things that you ask the Father, verily, verily, he'll give it to you. What did it say again, brother? All things. Read it one more time first, please,
brother. And in that day ye shall ask me nothing. Verily, 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 I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it.
1 John chapter 5, verse 13 through 15. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hears whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of him. I know that the Bible talks about God not answering the prayers of those that are sinning. But if we're living right, and we know that our sins are forgiven, and we're doing what we're supposed to be doing, does the Bible tell us that God will not answer our prayers? He said, whatsoever we ask according to his will. 9 times out of 10, if we pray, are we asking according to God's will, do you believe? Number 10 being the one that we go out into the car dealership, we lay our hands on the most expensive car and pray that God give it to us. That's ruling that one out. Not flat and rather. But 9 times out of 10, if we're praying, I'd say that we're probably praying for personal matters, finances, maybe lost loved ones, healings. Are these contrary to the will of God? Are we praying amiss? No. God said don't worry about tomorrow because tomorrow will take care of itself. He'll provide all of the finances that we need. Now, I'm not saying go and quit your job and be stupid, but if we are doing our best, God will take care of tomorrow. If we're praying for healing, is that according to God's will? Absolutely is according to God's will. We talked about this, I think it was last week, or at least we've talked about it in the past. If you went through what Christ went through for our healing, if you are being beyond recognition that someone might be healed, if you were whipped with a cat of nine tails that your skin hung off your back of ribbons, if you were beat so much that your kidneys were exposed for someone's healing, do you think that when somebody asked you to heal them that you wouldn't be willing to heal them? You went through all that for them. Of course you want to heal them. When it comes to praying for our lost loved ones, family members, people we work with, is that praying amiss? How can we pray amiss when the Son of God, the whole mission that he came to earth was to seek and to save that which is lost? The majority of the time, we're not praying amiss. But why aren't our prayers being answered? And I know that the devil fights against them. I'm not saying that. But is God answering these prayers? Does he desire to answer those prayers? We've just read that whatsoever we ask in his name, he'll give it to us. Of course he wants to answer. But maybe are there times when we doubt? Did God really hear my prayer? Is God really sending an answer? Well, what did James say about those moments? Let him pray in faith. Nothing wavered. Is the enemy going to try to throw thoughts of doubt into our mind? Is he going to try to make us question that God's even listening or answering our prayers? Absolutely. But it's in those times, guess who it falls on to fight? It's our responsibility. And we need to tell him, devil, get thee behind the scene. If it feels like it's our own mind that's telling us, well, maybe God's not listening. Sometimes it's the enemy. But if we've gotten ourselves into a weak mindset, it's our responsibility that we need to push off those thoughts. Say, you know what? Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. If God said he'll do it, then he'll do it. And we have to make up our mind. It is a fight, and it is a struggle. But God wants to answer our prayers. God wants to have signs and wonders following us. He didn't say it just to speak. But it's a promise. Signs and wonders will follow them that believe. But whose responsibility is it? It's ours. It's ours to make sure that we're right with God. It's our responsibility to make sure that we're living right. But it's also our decision whether or not we're going to step outside of our comfort zone. It's our decision whether or not we're going to pray over somebody in public that they would receive that healing. It is our decision that when those thoughts of doubt come into our mind, that we push them aside and say, that Jesus said it, I believe it, that's good enough for me. Sometimes we need to force ourselves into that childlike mentality with God. And the fact that if he said it, I'm not going to question it. Because guess what happens if you question it? It might not happen. Because he that wavered, let him ask of God, nothing wavered. Okay, I need to stop here. Any thoughts, any questions? Anything you'd like to add? If not, then we'll bow our heads and prepare our hearts for service. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you all praise and glory for everything you've done for us and shall continue to do. Lord, even right now we rebuke every attack of the enemy that should come our way. We pray that you set your angels by the four corners of the property above and below, that no attack of the enemy may penetrate. I pray that our hearts and our minds would be in one mindset, one accord, that we may worship you in sincerity and truth, and the Holy Ghost may move, making himself visible if he so chooses, Lord. Even right now, I pray, Lord, that our minds and our hearts would be prepared, that they'd be good soil for your word to fall, Lord, that we may remember in your word throughout the week, but even greater than that, that would take root in our hearts. I know the song leader and the musicians, as they lead us in the songs you'd have us sing, as they praise you upon the string instruments and the vocal cords, Lord. I pray, Lord, that the Holy Ghost would just rest upon this place, Lord, even right now, and that the spirit of peace would just overcome everyone that enters this building, Lord. That we may be in one mindset and one accord, that we may be in harmony, that the Holy Ghost may move, make himself visible, and so he chooses, Lord. That the Father may be magnified and glorified above all. Anointing the pastor as he brings forth the word today, anointing mine and his lips to bring forth the words you have us to hear, and may they fall in good soil, Lord. May we be willing vessels to be used of you inside of the church building and outside as well. May we grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ, Lord, that we may be willing vessels that you can use anywhere at any time. May we draw closer to you, Lord, that we may hear your voice like never before. You said that your sheep know your voice. But Lord, may we be willing to step outside of our comfort zone, that we may see signs and wonders happening in our lives, Lord. May they not be a thing of the past, and it may be not a thing large scale, Lord, for we do not desire, Lord, fame. We do not desire to grow a large head, Lord. We do not desire that pride should creep up within our life, Lord. But may we ever remain humble before you. But may we see signs and wonders follow us that believe that the Father would be magnified and glorified, that true Christianity would arise once again, that revival would occur here in Miracle Revival Church and within this valley. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.